Welcome back to another episode of the Shredding for Gold podcast. I'm your host, Emily Trepanier, and I'm happy to have you all here and listening. Just a few notes before we get started into our next podcast episode. Be sure to check out our website for all of our podcast episodes and exciting news. You can find us at www.shreddingforgold.com. That's www.shreddingforgold.com. And we'll be sure to have that link in the description below so that you can easily find it. Also, a huge shout out to the blind blogger and the folks at Blueberry who are helping put this podcast on the air and out there so you all can listen. Be sure to check out the What's Your Excuse Network, which hosts this podcast, and you can find it at www.wyexcuse.com. So www.wyexcuse.com, and so you can find this podcast and as well as much more. So be sure to check those out. So today on the podcast, in my last episode, we started talking with my coaches that have helped me as I continue to train towards the Paralympics. I thought it would be fun to switch it up just for this episode and to chat with somebody that helped me get into the world of snowboarding. So I'm not going to give you a whole lot of information, but I will tell you that she is one of my best friends that I've had for well over 10 years. I think it's been closer to 20 years, to be honest. But I'm so grateful to have her in my life, and she is actually the reason how I got into snowboarding. And so we're about to find out, well, you the listeners are about to find out how she helped me get into the land of snowboarding. So today we're going to be introducing you and interviewing my best friend, Lindsay Ng. So it's going to be very exciting, and very excited for you all to meet her and learn a little bit about Lindsay and how it was that I got into snowboarding. So let's listen in. Okay, welcome to the Shredding for Gold podcast. Today we have Lindsay Ng on the show that I'm really excited to be talking to. First off, Lindsay, welcome to the podcast. Thank you so much for agreeing to come on and being interviewed. I'm very excited.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm very excited to see what podcasts come out.
Yes, it's going to be awesome. All right, so let's start off super easy, Linz. Who are you? Give the listener a little bit of a description of who you are so they can start to get to know you.
Well, my name is Lindsay Ng. When I first met Emily, I once went by Lindsay Bjor. I got married, can you believe, 6 years ago.
Has it already been 6 years?
Wow. It's been 6 years. And I met Emily at the School for the Blind in Brantford, W. Ross McDonald School for the Blind. I am also visually impaired. I am what they call an albino, so I have very fair skin and very, very sensitive eyes, and white hair. Well, okay, right now it's pink, but it normally is white. What else can I tell you about myself? I once liked to snow or to ski, and that's how I got Emily into skiing.
Yeah, that's why we have you on the podcast. So that's actually a really good segue to my next question, Lindz. When did you first start skiing / snowboarding? And did you start off as a skier, or did you start off snowboarding right away?
Oh, geez, this is gonna be a fun one. You're pulling my memory here. I started skiing when I was 4 years old, and we have a ski hill here in Kitchener, where I'm originally from, and it's called Chicopee Ski Hill, and my brothers would go there skiing, and my family went there skiing, and we heard about this program, and it was called Track 3, and it was for people who had all various disabilities. There was people who were in wheelchairs who used sit skis, and there was people who were amputees, there were people who were blind, there were people with intellectual disabilities, you name it, we had them there. And awesome. So I started skiing with them, and I loved it.
When did you start skiing with them?
I would have been 4 or 5 years old, I think.
Okay.
So that would have been like...
Yeah, prior to skiing with them, did you ski with your family at the hill, or...?
Yes, I did, but I didn't quite like it because I have some pretty crazy horror stories of my mother running over me.
Oh, no.
Because at the time, back in the day, there wasn't a lot, and we didn't know about all the different adaptive technology that we can use nowadays.
Right.
And so I was tethered to my mom, and we had a few accidents that I refused to ski with her ever since then. So
did you get injured from them? And obviously you're okay, or just
I'm
like,
okay,
just some scars.
I think it was just spooked. I think just it was just spooked.
Okay, so you started skiing when you were 3 years old, and then you started with the Track 3 program when you were 4 or 5, correct?
Correct.
Okay, and you started skiing with them, obviously?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. And how long did you ski with them until you switched over to snowboarding? Do you remember?
I skied with them for a good while. I would have been then... started at W. Ross in 1999, and that was then when I met Emily. Mm-hmm. And I was leaving every Wednesday night from school. My parents would pick me up and they would take me to Track 3.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time, Emily's like, well, what's Track 3 all about? So as I explained earlier, I told her about what Track 3 was and what they did. And so she asked to join and asked her mom, and her mom said yes. So she then started coming out with me to Track 3, to skiing. And she was skiing because she said, you know, if my friend Lindsay can ski, I can ski.
And were you skiing at the time, or were you snowboarding?
Yeah,
then?
I was skiing when you joined.
Okay, okay. For some reason, I thought you had been snowboarding, but...
No.
Huh, okay.
I was still skiing.
Okay.
And that's then cool. One evening, a good friend of mine, John and Taffy,
mm-hmm.
were like, do you want to try snowboarding? And I'm like, because I always saw people snowboarding. It's like, man, snowboarding's so much easier than skiing because you only have one freaking board. You don't have two skis on your feet, and you're not...
Right.
Taking one leg one way and one leg the other way. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. I said, let's do it. Let's try it out.
Yeah, and just for the listener's sake, John is actually was one of Lindsay's snowboard instructors at the time. So
yes, sorry for to add that in.
No worries. No worries. All right.
And Taffy was one of the other instructors that was a part of Track 3. So. Okay. They introduced me to snowboarding, and then Taffy went off and worked with some other people, and then I got this really, I hope my husband's not listening, he's out in the other room, but got this really, 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 really hot snowboard instructor along with John, and ask me what his name is, I don't remember.
You forget his name?
but he was drop dead gorgeous. I loved him. And so Emily joined track three. I was still in, I was still skiing. And it was probably a couple of months into Emily joining, I then decided that I'm ditching skiing and I'm going to snowboarding. So I ditched skiing and went over to snowboarding. And at that time, Emily, we said to Emily, do you want to try? And Emily's like, I'm kind of scared. And so from my recollection of it, she then came across and was like, you know, if my friend who's also visually impaired can do it, what's stopping her or what's stopping me from doing it? So that evening, we got Emily out on a board, and, well, let's say it wasn't pretty, but every time you start out with something new, it's not always pretty.
Not always going to be pretty, but
Emily is now where she is with snowboarding, and
for sure
is now making her way, hopefully, to the Paralympics.
That's the goal. So that's awesome, Lilins. Can you remember one of your favorite memories of being at the Hill? You have a favorite memory that stands up for you?
Oh, gosh.
You have a few, you can say, like, a few. But
we have a very good one. I used to joke around with my snowboard instructors, and we used to say, I always wanted a hot chocolate halfway through. So we used to always, and I always loved, like, they used to have to bribe me with candy. And, well, I said, I want some candy. And my one snowboard instructor pulled a carrot out of his pocket. Yes, that's right. You heard me correctly. A carrot. A
carrot. Wow.
And I was like, I don't want a carrot. I want a hot chocolate and some candy. So I'll always remember the carrot or the time that I ran into the fence and made friends with the fence.
Yeah, those fences can be friendly sometimes and evil sometimes. Yeah, I've definitely ran into my share of those fences. So have you ever ran into any of those wood fences, you too? I've only had one encounter with the wood fence, and that was more than enough for me, but
no, I have to say, I don't think I've ran into a wood fence.
Okay, just all the orange fences?
All the orange, meshy.
Orange mesh fences, yeah.
Plasticky fences.
Well, that's good. You've never ran into a wood fence, because those aren't fun to run into, but, you know, it happens sometimes.
Oh, just for sure.
Dust yourself up. Just keep going.
Yep.
All right. Did you find when you first started snowboarding it challenging at all? And if so, what challenges did you encounter with snowboarding?
I thought when I started snowboarding that it was just like, let's go straight down the hill. Well, I learned pretty easy that it wasn't straight down the hill. And you really have to pay attention, because back when I was snowboarding, we had none of the technology to stay connected with our snowboard instructors. So I had to really focus on listening to that person's voice, because they're going to tell you to turn left or right.
Right, right.
And you have to remember that there's other people who are on the hill as well, who are also a part of the track three program. So you're trying to really focus on, okay, who's saying left, who's saying right? Try not to listen to somebody else's left and right to make sure that it's your left and your... person who's guiding you left and right, because you can have a little bit of an accident.
Yeah, if you follow the wrong person, well, you're going on an adventure.
Yeah, I don't think you want to go on an adventure, depending on where that adventure takes you to, but...
That is true. If it's like a soft, like, snow drift or something, that would be fun, but...
Yes, yes.
Yeah, anything hard or anything would not be fun, so...
No, I've run into a few people, too.
Yeah, I've done that, too. That's fun and exciting when that happens.
Yeah.
It's so a lot of you fun. Found, like, concentrating...
Concentrating was difficult.
Yeah.
Because I have a little bit of ADHD.
Fair enough. Fair enough. Did you find anything else challenging about snowboarding? Was one turn harder to do versus the other turn? I know for me that toe turns. I was going to say, for me, it's toe turns that they've gotten a lot better, but I know that, like, if I had to choose one turn that's a little bit more challenging for me, it would be definitely my toe turn. So. Yeah.
Oh my gosh, my toe turns are... They took me forever. I don't know how many times I had to have my guide basically take off his board, and he had to walk me. We'd go to the baby hills, yeah. And he would walk me through doing a toe turn, because I could not do it.
Yeah.
And now I'm pro.
It takes a lot of, like, foot strength and stuff. They're really challenging, and so if you don't have that strong, like, foot strength and base, it's going to be really challenging to do those. So,
well, it's your foot strength and your core, because, like, your
foot strength, core, and, like, balancing and everything. Yeah, because you've got to, like, balance on your toes, right? So,
balancing on the edge of your board.
Yeah. Right?
If anybody's seen a snowboard, sometimes they can be smaller, sometimes they can be bigger. It depends on what type of board you're using.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, it all depends on the board that you're using. You're right. Some are smaller, some are larger. So, yeah. So, when you first started, did you have... What adaptive equipment, if any, did you use when you first started snowboarding? I know you mentioned the tether.
Tethering was for skiing.
Tether was for skiing, okay. Did you use a tether for snowboarding at all, or no?
No.
No, that's cool.
No.
Yeah. I think I only lasted in the tether like an hour, and then they took it off because it was a bit of a disaster to use. So.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think. We had aprons. We called them like skier bibs were bright orange with black writing.
Yeah.
And one would say guide and one would say blind skier. Well, when I started snowboarding, I was like, I'm not a skier. I'm a snowboarder. So we took duct tape and we duct taped over the skier, and we put blind border bunny.
I remember
that this. Was my nickname on the this. Hill.
Yeah.
So I had the blind border bunny, and they actually let me keep it.
Really? I was like, you got to keep it. That's awesome.
Yeah. I was with Track 3 pretty much when they started.
Okay.
Everybody knew me.
Right.
So, that was about the only technology or adaptive stuff that we had for snowboarding back then.
For sure. Definitely grown since then. Because I know, like, for me, now we're using headsets and we're using headsets that go underneath my helmet, and then bear bells and stuff. So it's definitely, like, developed over the years, that's for sure, which is pretty exciting and cool to see. Those headsets definitely would have been super useful back then when we first both started snowboarding, right? So,
oh, gosh, yeah. Make life a lot easier.
It gets so loud on the hill sometimes. It's super hard for us to hear our guides and coaches, right?
Or if you have a race going on next to you.
Yeah.
Chicopee had a lot of races going on, so they could be a hill or two away from you, and it could sometimes make it a little bit hard to hear your guide.
For sure. Yeah. Yeah, definitely. So what is your favorite brand of snowboard? And why?
My favorite band of snowboard is Burton. Why? Because I tried a few different ones. When I first started out, I had an oxygen board. I didn't mind it, but it just wasn't, it didn't feel right.
Right.
Burton all the way. I like the weight of it. I like the feeling of it. And you have to understand that when you're dealing with a visually impaired person and snowboarding, and if you do have sight, some sight, if your coach or your guide tells you, look straight ahead, so your feet are on your board, look straight ahead, look as if you're looking over the tip of your board, you want to be able to see that board. So I found when board hunting, that sounds funny, when searching for a board, I have found that,
Board
yeah, when
hunting
searching for a board, I have found that Burton has a lot of darker colored boards.
works too.
Because if you get the lighter colors, they're gonna blend in with the snow, and that's just gonna make it so much more difficult for somebody such as ourselves to see that board.
For sure.
And
Yeah,
so
definitely.
I found Burton just so much more adaptive, and they just, I don't know, it's their bindings are just so much easier to get into and
They have so many
easy.
different types of bindings now, too, which
Oh
is kind
gosh,
of neat.
yeah.
Yeah. I they
And
have like.
may I add that they're so much better than ski boots?
Oh my goodness. Yes, I have to 100% agree with you. Being a skier and then switching over to snowboarding. Oh my God. I could live in my snowboard boots like all day if I wanted to. My feet would probably kill me because I'd get like sores and stuff on my ankles and stuff from like wearing my boots for so long. But they're so much comfier than ski boots for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No offense to
No,
any of the blind skiers out there,
definitely
but
not. No offense at all. But yeah, if I had to choose between the two, I would definitely live in my snowboard boots versus ski boots. For sure. All
yes. But
right.
yeah, no, I'd have to say my Burton board is
Awesome.
probably one that I'd go to.
Awesome. Do you have a favorite memory of us at the hill while we were snowboarding with Track 3 that
Oh
you'd like to
gosh.
share?
You're pulling out some. I'm trying to think.
I'm making you think.
Yeah. Should have given me these questions earlier there, Missy.
Yeah, I did give you a little bit earlier, so.
Yeah, not a lot. Memories.
Memories. Any
I
memories?
remember watching Emily go down the hill. And she had, I think she had one of my guides,
I
because
got ahead, John, I think.
I was at the time, I was, obviously more adaptive to boarding. So
Right, you've been snowboarding for a little longer.
Emily had John, and I remember just whizzing past him and then stopping halfway down the hill and just sitting there watching her try to struggle to get down the hill because I was that mean friend, and just
Those first few
I was trying to be a little a bump in the road, if you may call it
those
too.
first few years were a struggle.
Yes, they were. But no, we always used to go in for hot chocolate and talk about our our struggles and what things worked.
Yep. What didn't?
I'm just remembering Emily and I were still at the School for the Blind in Brantford, and we were going home or coming to track three, and
I remember this one. I remember
it
this
was
one.
Christmas time, and Emily's mom, Apple, and her sister Natalie were bringing us from Brantford to Kitchener.
As they often would. They would, like, switch from Lindsay's parents would sometimes bring us, and then sometimes my mom and sisters would bring me, so.
And, well, it was more your parents, or mom and sister dropping us off.
Yeah.
Because then they weren't getting home so late. But,
that's right, yeah.
The one evening we were just driving down the road, and we came past this sign. I, obviously, being visually impaired, was like, what's that sign say? And, well, Natalie, her sister, goes, I don't know, let me look. And now, let's get this straight so our viewers understand that Natalie was in the passenger seat. She was not driving.
Yeah, no, Natalie was in the passenger seat, and she's definitely fully sighted, so.
So, she's like, Seasons greetings? And I don't even think it said that, but to this day, every time I go past there,
I always laugh. Wasn't it like a factory or something?
It was a factory.
It was a factory, that's right. And the sign on the factory said Seasons greetings. So.
And, well, another one to go along with that story is, I don't remember who told us, but did you know if you go through Tim Hortons and you have a dog in the car, you get Timbits?
Well, for free.
For free. So I was like, guys, I'm going to try it. So I always would sit in the back seat and it barked like a dog. And I got Timbits. Got free Timbits for barking like a dog.
Oh my goodness. Yes, I do remember this.
Or I used to sleep with my helmet on in the car. And they used to always make fun of me. And they used to be like, what? Protecting your head? I'm like, no, my helmet's just very comfortable. My helmet also was, I think it was a Burton.
Okay.
But I always slept with my helmet on. And got Timbits from Tim Hortons. So easy, if anybody's food. Listening out there, then if you need some free food, get into a car with somebody you know and bark like a dog, and you might just get yourself some free Timbits.
Oh my goodness, Lynn. That's awesome. That's great advice for our listeners.
Yeah, you gotta give them some good advice.
Indeed. Whatever sports besides snowboarding have you done?
I was a competitive swimmer, and seeing that we've just passed the Summer Olympics, I'm looking to get back into swimming. But as I said earlier in the show, due to having pink hair when I shower, my pink hair dye comes out slowly, so I don't think the public pool or the pool where I live would like to see a pink trail behind me as I'm swimming. Yeah, so
probably not.
I think I will wait until my hair dye comes out and things get ease up with this whole pandemic that we're going through as of right now. Mm-hmm. I am a competitive swimmer. I was somewhat of a competitive goal ball player.
Okay.
If nobody understands goal ball, it is played on a pretty big court if we had the size of it, and you have a center, a right wing, and a left wing, and you're trying to defend the ball from getting in the net behind you. Mm-hmm. And
everyone's blindfolded too, so.
Yes, you're blindfolded. Swimming, snowboarding, skiing, and goalball. I think that's all. Okay. I don't think there's any other sports.
Oh, okay. That's cool. So you mentioned you wanted to get back into swimming. Do you have any goals that you want to work on for swimming, or you just want to get back into the pool for swimming?
I would like to, if there's anybody out there who has stopped and was competitively swimming and wants to get back into it, some goals that I am coming up with is, if you go to Swimming Canada, excuse me, if you're swimming in Canada, you can look up your times from when you were swimming. So that's quite funny. I've seen times of when Emily was swimming with me back in the day.
Yes.
You can see those times, so I think I'm going to take those times that I was swimming and make those my goals to beat.
That's awesome.
And maybe one day I will be at the Paralympics, but on the other, I'll be in the summer and Emily will be in the winter. So
that's true. Wow, that's amazing. I wish you best of luck with that, Lince.
Thank you.
If you had to give any advice to a snowboarder just starting out, what's some advice that you would give them?
Well, this is for anybody.
Mm-hmm.
Snowboarder, skier, swimmer, golf ball player, don't give up. Especially for snowboarding, you know, you're going to fall. You're going to...
Yes.
You might run into things. You might get bruises. You might have a really sore bum. You might have to put a few cushions on your little tush to keep your butt from hurting.
Right.
But don't give up. Just get up. Keep trying. Keep going. Keep doing it. It's going to take time. I wasn't perfect at it when I started. I'm still not 100% perfect. But don't give up. Just keep trying. The impossible is only the untried. So just keep on, you know, some days you're going to have really bad days, but just remember that the next day is going to be a different day, and, you know, get out there and try again. So don't give up. And yeah, it's hard, but once you get used to it, you will love it and you won't want to stop.
Amazing advice, Lince. Thank you so much for coming on to the Shredding for Gold podcast. This has been super fun to have you on and learn a little bit and have the listeners learn a little bit more about you and how I kind of got involved in snowboarding because of you. So thank you so much for being on the podcast, Lince.
Thank you very much.
Excellent. All right. Thank you all for listening to the Shredding for Gold podcast. We'll be back next week for another Shredtastical episode on Shredding for Gold podcast. I'm your host, Emily Trepanier, and we'll see you soon.